Students, we are starting a new chapter, Human Health and Diseases. In this, we will first start discussing what is meant by health, immunity, and we are going to learn different definitions. Let us start now. Health and hygiene. How will you define health? What do you understand by a healthy person? Is it just not having any illness or ailment? Let us understand. Health is not merely absence of disease or physical fitness. World Health Organization or WHO has defined health as the state of complete physical, mental and social well-being and not merely the absence of disease or infirmity or weakness. In short, health is the birthright of humans. Health also reflects the metabolic and functional efficiency of living organisms. That means we have to consider three aspects here. Physically, the person should be fit. He shouldn't have any physical abnormality or diseases. Mentally also, he has to be in well-being. And socially, he should have interactions and he should have social well-being. Then what is hygiene? Hygiene is a science of rules of health. How a person can keep healthy? By maintaining hygiene. To achieve good health, hygienic balanced diet, clean drinking water, personal and community hygiene, regular physical exercise, knowledge about diseases and their effects on body, proper disposal of waste, control of vectors such as mosquitoes, fleas, flies, etc. is very essential. In short, we need to maintain a good hygiene to achieve good health. Now, we are going to talk about immunity. When we talk about immunity, we refer to it as resistance by the host towards injury caused by pathogens and their products. A person, now for example, is immune to a particular disease. When we say that, it means that the host or the person exhibits resistance against that injury. Immunity is freedom or exempt from the disease. Now, immunology is a branch of science which deals with the study of immune system, immune responses to foreign substances and their role in resisting infection by pathogens. So what are the important points here? It studies immune system, then how this system responses to foreign substances and how it resists the infection by pathogens. Most important characteristic of immune system that it should have ability to distinguish own body cells and foreign molecule or the pathogen invading the body cells. Now here two concepts are very important. Antigen. Antigen is any foreign substance invading body and is capable of stimulating an immune response. Now you need to understand this very carefully. When you are taking inside food, that is also a foreign substance, but is it an antigen? No. But if the food is spoiled, if you take it inside, it is infected with the bacteria or pathogens, then definitely it is going to cause an immune response. Your body will react to it. So, such a foreign substance, which is capable of stimulating an immune response. Now this word is very important here. It should stimulate an immune response, that is an antigen. What are antibodies? The protective chemicals produced by immune cells in response to antigen. Now suppose a virus enters your systems or your body. Against that virus, there are certain chemicals or immunoglobulins or certain protein molecules are produced in your body to fight with that. with the invading pathogen. That those are antibodies. These two definitions are very important when we understand the immune system. Now, types of immunity. First is innate or inborn immunity, which is present by birth. Now, it has different barriers such as epithelial surface, antimicrobial substances in blood and tissue, cellular factors, fever, and acute phase proteins. This package you are born with. So, this is innate or inborn immunity. Then the next is acquired or adaptive immunity. When an organism is born, after the birth, organism tries to adapt to the environment. The organism acquires or adapts immunity, and that is called as acquired immunity. It has different features: specificity, diversity, discrimination between self and non-self, and memory. These are the characteristic features of adaptive immunity. Then the types, it has two types again: active immunity and passive immunity. Active immunity has two types: naturally acquired active immunity and artificially acquired active immunity. In passive immunity also, it is acquired naturally and artificially. So, two subtypes of acquired immunity are active and passive, and in both these types there are further subtypes: naturally acquired active immunity and artificially acquired active immunity. In passive, naturally acquired passive immunity and artificially acquired passive immunity. Then we are going to talk about innate immunity or inborn immunity. It is resistance to infection due to his or her genetic makeup. We often say that a person is very strong. His or her constitution is strong. What does that mean? Generally, the person with a stronger constitution or a stronger resistance is not susceptible easily to the diseases. There are few persons which catch cold very easily. What can we say? They are susceptible, they are weaker in constitution. So genetic makeup of an individual also plays an important role in the immunity. Then this is inborn or natural defense system of body. Then it is not affected by prior contact with microorganisms or immunization. In acquired immunity, although if you have prior infection to a certain pathogen, for example cold, then in the second encounter you will not have the infection to a greater extent. But in acquired immunity, but in innate immunity, it is not affected by prior contact with microorganisms. It is non-specific when degree of resistance is concerned in general, but it is specific when a particular pathogen is concerned. Then it comprises of various types of barriers which are helpful in preventing entry of foreign agents into our body. Now let us see which are those. First is epithelial surface and mucous membrane. Now in the diagram you can see here mouth cavity is shown, and a small portion of mouth cavity is enlarged to show the epithelial surface or mucosal surface, and skin, section of skin is also shown. Epithelial surface, it plays a very important role in preventing the entry of microorganisms. How? Intact skin and mucus covering protect or prevent invasion of microorganism. Healthy skin, which is not broken, has bactericidal activities. How does it happen? We have sweat glands and sebaceous glands in our skin. When sweat dries up, it has a lot of salts in it, So due to these salts, the bacteria get killed and it has antibacterial activity. Then sebaceous gland or secretes sebaceous secretions, oily secretions, and long chain fatty acids, they have bactericidal and fungicidal properties. So both these glands in our skin play very important role in preventing entry of microorganisms. Then mucosa of respiratory tract has several innate mechanisms of defense. Let us see how. Nose prevents the entry of microorganisms because at the nasal orifice or near the external nares, we have hair. Air is filtered and those pathogens are trapped there. Those pathogens which can pass beyond, they are trapped in the mucus lining epithelium and swept back into pharynx. They are not allowed to go in the respiratory tract. They are pushed into pharynx and swallowed and coughed out. Okay. So coughing is a very important defense mechanism of respiratory tract. You can easily relate it. When there is a lot of dust around, you start sneezing and coughing. So that is a defense mechanism to push out the dust particles and along with that pathogens also outside and in pharynx. Mouth is constantly bathed in saliva. Buccal cavity is moist due to saliva, which has inhibitory effect on microorganisms. And gastric secretion. In our stomach, there are highly acidic gastric secretion. HCl is secreted in stomach, which destroys microorganisms. And flushing action of urine eliminates bacteria from urethra. Such are the defense mechanisms by birth given to us. So this was the first barrier, epithelial surface of innate immunity. And then spermin and zinc also in semen, male reproductive discharge, they are also antibacterial. Then the second barrier is antimicrobial substances in blood and tissue. There is a system called as complement system, which have more than 30 serum proteins circulating in blood in inactive state. Now these are proteins which are not active. They are present in blood in inactive state, but they are activated when there is a pathogen attack. This eliminates. Now these inactive complement system proteins become active and they help in elimination of pathogens. There is a class of cytokines or soluble proteins called as interferons, which are released by cells infected with viruses. Now here I have shown a diagram wherein you can see this is the infected cell. It is releasing the interferons, which are shown by red colored dots. These interferons bind to the receptors on the neighboring cells. After binding the interferons, the neighboring cells are signaled and the neighboring cells stimulate other cells to protect themselves from viral infection. Sorry, the one which is affected, that cell signals the neighboring cells to protect themselves from viral infection. So this is how, by release of interferons, the signal is given to the adjacent cells to get protection from viral infection. Then the next barrier is cellular factor in innate immunity. Naturally, the invasion of microorganisms and foreign particles is prevented by prevented to a large extent by phagocytic cells. Now, phagocytic cells are those which literally ingest and destroy the pathogens, and these are grouped as microphages and macrophages. When we study blood cells, we group them as red blood cells, white blood cells and platelets. In white blood cells, there are the granulocytes, which are called as monocytes. Monocytes differentiate into macrophages, and these are the eating cells or phagocytic cells which go to the site of injury and eat up the debris or dead cells or phagocytes. There is a class of lymphocyte called as natural killer cells. They are important in non-specific infection, non-specific defense against viral infections. Now here you can see natural killer cells and tumor cells. These natural killer cells eat up or they destroy the tumor cells. Then the fourth barrier is fever, which is again you experience fever and you feel a little anxious, but actually fever is a defense mechanism. How does it prevent the entry of destroy the invading pathogens? Increase in the body temperature helps to accelerate physiological process to destroy the invading pathogens. Fever stimulates the production of interferons and helps recovery from viral infections. So fever is actually an important barrier of innate immunity. Then lastly, acute phase proteins or APPs. Now, infection or injury leads to a sudden increase in concentration of certain proteins called as acute phase proteins. Now here the list is given: C-reactive proteins, mannose binding protein, alpha van acid glycoprotein and serum amyloid P, etc. These are very much responsible for enhancing host resistance, preventing tissue injury and promoting repair of inflammatory regions. So these proteins are also the natural barriers. Now the next type of immunity is acquired immunity. This is the resistance that an individual acquires during his life. It is, as we know, as the individual is adapting, so the name to this immunity is given as adaptive or specific immunity. Now in this, there is formation of antibodies which neutralize the antigen. Now what are the unique features? Specificity. It can produce specific antibody or T lymphocyte against a particular antigen or pathogens. There are different types of pathogens around in our environment: bacterial, viral. So these have different antibodies. Against these, different antibodies are produced due to the acquired immunity. Diversity. It can recognize a vast variety of diverse pathogens and foreign molecules. That is one feature of acquired immunity. Third and most important is it differentiates between own cells and foreign molecules. And memory. It has memory of its first encounter with pathogen. So when the same pathogen again attacks the next time, this immunity is ready to fight with the pathogen. Okay, so when the immune system encounters a specific foreign agent, it generates an immune response, eliminates the invader. This is the first encounter. The immune system retains the memory of the first encounter. So when the same pathogen is encountering the second time, the quicker and stronger immune response is generated due to the acquired immunity. Now, two types of acquired immunity: active immunity and passive. Resistance developed by individual as a result of antigenic stimulus. Adaptive immunity, it may be natural or artificial. Natural acquired active immunity is, it is acquired due to infection. When a person gets infected with a pathogen, there are antibodies produced against it. Okay. For example, a person who has recovered from attack of measles develops natural acquired active immunity to to measles for a lifetime. Now, again, when this pathogen attacks the body, there is already the immunity of body against this pathogen. Artificial acquired immunity is by vaccines. Vaccines are introduced into body to stimulate formation of antibodies in the immune system. Example, polio or BCG vaccine. Now these vaccines are nothing but the inactive pathogens only. The pathogens in non-virulent form or the pathogens which are killed or their effectivity is gone. Now when these vaccines are introduced, body recognizes the pathogens as the invaders and body produces antibodies against the dead pathogens. But still the immune response is greater. So this, such an immunity may be temporary or permanent. Then passive immunity. It is acquired when ready-made antibodies are received. Now here the host is not making antibodies. Inside the body of host, ready-made antibodies are introduced. Body cells do not take any active part in the production of immunity. It can be either acquired naturally or artificially. The first type is natural acquired passive immunity. Before birth, maternal antibodies are transferred from mother to fetus through placenta. So the fetus is not making the antibodies. The fetus is receiving the ready-made antibodies from its mother. After birth, antibodies are transferred from mother to infant through colostrum, the first milk of mother. Here also, the antibodies from mother are received by the infant. See, these antibodies remain for a shorter time. Therefore, this immunity is short-lived. Natural acquired passive immunity is short-lived. As long as the child is breastfeeding, the child is receiving the antibodies, but after that it stops. Then artificially acquired passive immunity. Here the immunity is developed by injecting previously prepared antibodies into serum from humans or animals. Example, antibodies which are obtained from hyperimmunized horses. Antibodies which are prepared in some other organism or human are taken and these are injected into humans. Again here the host is not preparing the antibodies. He is receiving, but it is artificially received. So example is the antibodies against rabies which are produced in hyperimmunized horses are injected into humans. This is again short-lived. Then immune system. Here, just to make you understand what are the different organs and parts of immune system, I have shown you the diagram here. Here you can clearly see thymus gland, then Peyer's patches in intestine, lymphatic ducts and lymphatic nodes can be clearly seen. Here it is spleen. So here bone marrow. So these are all the organs of lymphatic system or immune system, we can say. Bone marrow, spleen, thymus gland, lymph nodes, lymphatic duct and tonsils, cells of immune system. Lymphocytes, these are most important cells. Like other blood cells, these are also arising from stem cells or hemocytoblasts which are present in liver of fetus and bone marrow in adult. Blood cells of fetus are formed in liver and in adult they are formed in bone marrow. Now here it is shown, it is a chart of the lymphocytes forming in bone marrow. Now from bone marrow you can see the stem cells which are differentiating into pre B lymphocytes and T lymphocytes. टी लिम्फोसाइट्स मैच्योर इन थाइमस. यू जस्ट हैव सीन इन प्रीवियस स्लाइड थाइमस, वेयर इज व्हाट इज द लोकेशन ऑफ थाइमस, इट इज अपर टू हार्ट. सो लिम्फोसाइट्स डिफरेंशिएट इनटू बी लिम्फोसाइट्स एंड टी लिम्फोसाइट्स. सम ऑफ द लिम्फोसाइट्स अंडरगो डिफरेंशिएशन इन गट असोसिएटेड बर्सल लिम्फोइड टिश्यू, टॉन्सिल्स एंड पेयर्स पैचेस एंड आर कॉल्ड एज बर्सल और बी लिम्फोसाइट्स. एंड अदर डिफरेंशिएट इनटू थाइमस ग्लैंड, इट इज कॉल्ड एज टी लिम्फोसाइट्स. Mature lymphocytes pass into blood fluids and circulate in body. Many of them stay in lymph nodes. B lymphocytes form antibody mediated immune system or humoral immune response they show, and T lymphocyte show cell mediated immune system. Now let us see what is that. Both immune systems need antigen to come into action, but they respond in different ways. Now we will see how the T lymphocytes respond to an antigen. Now antigen or any foreign pathogen, when it comes in contact with our body or when it invades the body, a T lymphocyte forms clones of T cells which are similar but they perform different functions. Now the different clones we are going to learn. Now here in the first chart I've shown you, when there is antigen, this antigen interacts with the antigen presenting cell, and here you can see the T helper cell. It helps in the immune response. It is responsible for production of lymphokines, which are helping in proliferation of other T cells, stimulation of B lymphocytes and macrophages. Then killer T cells or cytotoxic C cells. Now here you can see when the antigen is recognized, the C cells come in contact with them and they get activated. Then they attack the infected cell and literally destroy them or kill them. So that is why they are called as killer T cells. Now you will see these killer T cells, they are activating and destroying the cancer cells, and some cells are forming memory T cells. Now memory T cells are previously sensitized cells which retain the sensitization memory for a long time in future. They will retain the memory of encounter with the pathogen, and when the pathogen again invades or attacks, these cells will be helpful in killing that pathogen. And last is suppressor T cells. These suppress the entire immune system against the attack on own body cells after the infection is brought under control. Now this is also very important. After the infection is over, now the immune system has to stop its action, and it is done by suppressor T cells. Now how B lymphocytes react to an antigen. Here a B cell is shown when it is sensitized by antigen as well as T helper cell. Now your T helper cell is shown here and antigen is shown here. When it is interacting with both of them, it multiplies very fast to produce two kinds of cells. One is memory cells and other is plasma cells. Here you can see the plasma cells. Now plasma cells produce specialized glycoprotein called as antibodies. Now we keep saying when the pathogen encounters or when the pathogen invades our body, our body produces the immunoglobulins और प्रोटीन मॉलिक्यूल्स, केमिकल मॉलिक्यूल्स विच आर कॉल्ड एज एंटीबॉडीज. द एंटीबॉडीज आर प्रोड्यूस्ड बाय अ टाइप ऑफ बी सेल्स कॉल्ड एज प्लाज्मा सेल्स. दीज सर्क्यूलेट, दीज एंटीबॉडीज सर्क्यूलेट थ्रू ब्लड एंड लिम्फ. दीज आर कॉल्ड एज ह्यूमर. दैट इज वाई द इम्यून रिस्पॉन्स बाय बी लिम्फोसाइट्स इज कॉल्ड एज ह्यूमोरल और एंटीबॉडी मेडिएटेड इम्यून रिस्पॉन्स. देन एंटीबॉडी मॉलिक्यूल्स मे बाइंड टू सेल मेम्ब्रेन और दे मे रिमेन फ्री. एंड दीज मेमरी बी सेल्स रिटेन द मेमरी ऑफ द पैथोजन एनकाउंटर. सो इन बोथ द वेज और इन बोथ द इंटरैक्शंस, दैट इज टी लिम्फोसाइट इंटरैक्शन विद एंटीजन एंड बी लिम्फोसाइट इंटरैक्शन विद एंटीजन, वी सॉ दैट प्रेजेंस ऑफ एंटीजन एंड एक्टिवेशन ऑफ बी एंड टी सेल्स इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. बोथ नीड एंटीजन बट दे बोथ शो रिस्पॉन्स इन डिफरेंट वेज. वॉट इज द फंक्शन ऑफ फ्री एंटीबॉडीज? नाउ दीज फ्री सर्क्युलेटिंग एंटीबॉडीज यू कैन सी हियर. दीज आर द एंटीबॉडीज. दीज आर फॉर्मिंग अ कोट अराउंड द पैथोजन. Agglutination of particulate matter including bacteria and viruses. A clump is formed. Bacteria and viruses are trapped or immobilized in the agglutination. Then they have to be engulfed by phagocytes. Now here you can see a phagocytic cell. Opsonization or coating of bacteria to facilitate the phagocytosis by bacterium, that is called as opsonization. And then lastly is the neutralization of toxin released by bacteria. The bacteria or the pathogen is completely neutralized. These are the functions of antibodies. Each antibody is specific for a particular antigen. They are shape specific. Antigen and antibody interaction is like a lock and key interaction. Now, the next type of important cell of immune system is antigen presenting cell. Now here, sequence of events is shown. A bacterium is engulfed by a macrophage or phagocytic cell. It is digested and antigen is presented on the surface of macrophage. Now you will see in the second event the lysosomes or the vacuoles which contain digestive enzymes fuse with the bacterium and they completely break the bacteria inside the macrophage, and now antigen with major histocompatibility complex molecules or certain protein molecules, remember for now, these are presented on the surface of macrophage. Now here the events are given. Antigen presenting cells engulf invading pathogen, process the antigens, and then processed antigens are presented on own surface of macrophage. These cells are able to deliver a stimulatory signal that is necessary for activation of T helper cell. T helper cell binds to the it has a receptor which binds to the antigen which is presented on the macrophage and it is activated. So till here we have finished talking about health, hygiene, immunity, different types of immunity and cells of immune system. Thank you.